Well, I mean, obviously, I think Virginia Tech should be wrestling in Iowa, and when I say that, we're excited to go to Michigan, you know, wrestling a quality program like Michigan. I'm going to back up for a second.
Back to the state of Iowa from not being here for a long time, so welcome back, Kevin.
He called me names, he called me an orange, and he substituted that for pussy. I was late for some things as a kid, but I was never late for Iowa Public Television broadcast of Iowa wrestling.
I think it's a chicken blank move.
Has anyone ever called you an orange before in your life?
In the late 90s, Virginia Tech was, they made a splash higher. Keith Moreland was a guy from Iowa that had some pretty good credentials to him and very fun guy to be around. And he had some of his personal demons that he was dealing with in that era. And ultimately, I think that's what led to that team never really gelling. But when Moreland left, I remember sitting in the office at the Daily Press. I'm still working there. And, you know, I have not full time in the NWCA. And we got a press release faxed come over. And I'd heard brands being rumored at Virginia Tech that comes in. And it's like two lines, like tomorrow, major program announcement for the future of the Virginia Tech wrestling program. Of course, everybody in the office looks over and goes, "Hey, Jay, you know about this?" "Yeah, they're going to name Tom Brands head coach." His first year in Blacksburg was actually quite successful from a dual meet standpoint. They won 16 dual meets. Then you kind of clean house a little bit. Then you bring in your first class, Joey Slayton, Dan LeClaire, Brent Metcalf, Jay Borschel, and T.H. One of the top recruiting classes in the country. Like, there was a buzz about what Tom Brands was going to create at a non-traditional program.
After a season of turmoil, the Iowa wrestling department brings out a new leader. That's our top story tonight. Good evening, I'm Tina Stein.
And I'm Jason Eppner. That's right, Tina, real big news. Iowa wrestling has struggled the last few years, and today Athletic Director Bob Bowlesby announces a new leader. Let's send it over to DITV's Mike Wolin with the story.
Thanks, Jason. It was an exciting day for the Iowa wrestling program as the worst-kept secret in Iowa history came to fruition. Former Hawk and three-time national champion Tom Brands was named the new leader of the Iowa wrestling program.
There's something about that Brands-Gable thing that is kind of wired into the Hawkeye mentality from what I've understood over the years.
Where were you that day that Tom got hired? Do you remember where you were at?
Mark Perry's living room. Remember, it was in Coralville, Iowa. The feeling amongst the guys was like, It was a nervous excitement because you also have this relationship with Jimmy and the other staff too, right? Probably know you haven't been up to snuff. Now you have this whole new regime coming in. It's like the fear of what if or what's going to happen. Guys that were on the team at the time maybe were a little bit uneasy. Like it put a jolt of energy into the program. Tom Brands is a winner. Do I remember the day that I heard the VT5 was for sure coming to Iowa? No, I mean, I wouldn't have to hear that. It was just assumed. Like, they went to Virginia Tech because of Tom Brands. Joey Slayton, LeClaire, Borschel, all those guys, they trained in the Iowa freaking room since they were 10 years old. And Metcalf, T.H. Lee, Borschel, LeClaire, Slayton. Ooh, those guys were from Iowa. The majority of them wanted to wrestle Iowa anyways. So it was kind of a merging of a team along with a new regime coming in. But it seemed like to be an exciting time for the team.
Four-time state champ from Linmar High School, the pride of Linmar, comes off the All-American last year. Now a winner tonight against Iowa State.
Pretty good match for the Hawkeyes there.
Then like 2008, 9, 10, three in a row. It's like, boom, 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 Gable is back. Gable's on staff, actually. Gable's on staff in 2007 to 2008. I mean, Metcalf wins the Hodge. Everything's great in Iowa City.
There was a really bad taste in Hokie Nation's mouth about this. They feel that they were wronged. It didn't help matters that in one of the very first interviews, I think it was Wes Hand was quoted in saying, it's like, yeah, they're all coming with us. And I think that's what set Hokie Nation afire. It was what's going to happen now, because they're coming off a 1-16 year and all the studs left. And at one point, this hasn't really been talked about very much. They're going to drop the program. I'm like, no, they're not going to drop the program if they can't find a coach. That's just lazy. There were graphics made in the Tech athletic department, and a release, I believe, had been drafted. I cannot confirm the draft of the release, but I know the graphics were made. That was actually probably 24 hours away from actually happening before Kevin Dresser. Kevin Dresser, that's the one that Hokie Nation was kind of pointing to. It was like, we've got a national champion right here in the backyard. Why don't we hire him?
You know, we got 81st place in the nation in my first year at Virginia Tech, and 81 teams qualified. The next year, we got 79th in the nation, and 79 teams qualified.
Just opening thoughts on how you thought you guys did today.
I think we progressed.
The fact that Virginia Tech is now a national power, and then Dresser went from taking over again that dumpster fire and turning them into a program that eventually won a trophy.
What, you want to learn something?
Yes, I do.
So they were taking the conference dual meet champions, matching them up partially on rank, partially on location. And they also didn't want to match up teams that had already met before. And they went off the coaches poll. You match them up and you put them on location and you're going to have 8 superstar events. Okay, looking at the rankings, like, okay, well, who's going to wrestle who? Now, looked like it wasn't going to be a big problem until Virginia Tech beat NC State.
This is where you're getting into the discussion, okay, well, why does Virginia Tech not go to Iowa City?
The NWCA, and again, I appreciate all the work that those guys put in, but, you know, their out is well, the contract says that we all signed that we're going on the coaches' ranking, okay? If that was actually truth, they lied to me because they told me that wasn't the case, that there was a committee, the committee was going to decide, and the committee talked, and I know I talked to the committee members, there was more than one coach that stood up and talked on Virginia Tech's behalf. Not one stood up and talked about NC State.
A lot of speculation. I mean, I think it gave Dresser a bunch of talking points. I mean, look, he brought a team that had won one dual meet his first year there, the team he took over, all the way to the team that was number 4 in the country. I mean, I'm going to say there's more than enough bad blood from what happened with the VT5, right, or didn't happen, that Dresser wanted a shot at Brands.
So when the pairings come out for the dual series, this weekend of great wrestling matches, and Iowa didn't see Virginia Tech in the pairings, I knew this was going to be something different.
You know, let's face it, what do the wrestling fans want to see? Does Iowa wrestling fans want to see Iowa wrestle NC State? People out there see matchups and they know exactly what's going on. They didn't want to wrestle Virginia Tech. It's plain and simple.
Coach Dresser really has never sugarcoated his feelings on a lot of things.
Why does Iowa not want to wrestle? Because they don't want to lose to us. Because you know what? We got a better team this year than they do in a dual meet, I think.
Basically, you know, he said that Iowa's a bunch of oranges, you know, which was, he's calling Iowa a bunch of pussies, right?
When he drops the line, says, well, Iowa pussed out. And then he caught himself. He backtracked. He goes, well, my wife said you shouldn't call people. And he actually, you know, the P word. So we got to come up with a different word for him. Let's just call them oranges. They oranged out.
I'm ruffling feathers, and that's all right. I'm going to ruffle feathers on it because these guys, they doubt on it. You know what? And I'll use a nicer word. I'll come up with a neutral word like orange, right? So they're oranges, right? You get a chance to do something that's good for wrestling, I think. And I think there's a lot of people that wanted to see that match up because of your own personal agendas. And obviously there's a lot of history between Virginia Tech and Iowa. And we got guys on our staff right now that there's some bad blood with the staff at Iowa. But you make a choice that I think hurts your program, hurts the fans, just because of personal agendas.
And then we went live.
If you think you've been wrong on your opportunity to grab something, I probably call them pussies too.
So 2016, I'm out of Iowa City at this point. I landed in Ames, actually. And I remember hearing a little bit about it and just kind of like, what? You know, like, who calls somebody an orange? What does that mean? And then you do a little bit of research and it's like, oh, okay, came out of Virginia Tech. It came from Kevin Dresser, who, you know, that the guy that followed after Tom left. It's like, okay, like, start putting the pieces together. If you do a little bit of research, like, okay, there might still be a little bit of animosity or some, you know, hurt feelings, I suppose, based on the way Tom left Virginia Tech.
A lot of crazy talk all week that you guys don't want to wrestle Virginia Tech. What's going on with that? What do you say about that?
You bring that up. Look at your history. Look at your history. And you know what? I'll just say this. Virginia Tech made Tom Brands a liar. That's all I'll say.
Has anyone ever called you an orange before in your life?
No, but I did get a box of oranges sent to my office, and it was anonymous.
He said that somebody sent him oranges. Do you remember that at all?
I don't actually remember any
of
that.
That's fine. Okay, so we'll...
That's funny, though.
Yeah.
And I thought it was because this was the Orange Bowl, but that's not the case.
I remember Zeb Miller asking Tom about if he was an orange or not. He kind of played it off like he didn't want to acknowledge it. I know what Dresser's trying to do here, trying to get a soundbite. And I'm not going to give him the time, so like next question. Right? He kind of big-timed him.
Iowa State's got a job opening. We don't know who's going to get the job. Do you care who gets that job? Is that still going to be a rival? Are you guys still going to start that match on the calendar?
Absolutely. And, you know, all roads point to Kevin Dresser. He's an Iowa.
Hold on. I say, hold up. Wait a minute.
So Dresser accepts the job at Iowa State. And I'm very intrigued at that point in time because I believe that's right. You know, 2017, do the math here. I'm in Des Moines. I'm not covering wrestling full time, but obviously I still got a beat on things. And that's super interesting to me because one, I'm pretty sure that announcement comes before the national tournament. So it's like, okay, interesting, right? Because not long before then KJ decides to step down. So Iowa State moved pretty quickly. And instantly, like, I don't know that I like put the connection together that like, yeah, that's the same guy that yelled at Tom, or that's the same guy that called him an orange, or that's the, you know, like, I didn't really think of the animosity between Tom and Virginia Tech at that point in time. My thought was like, what does this mean for Iowa State?
So, you might wonder why Iowa State?
I've created a monster, cause nobody wants to see Marshall no more. They want Shady, I'm chopped liver.
Well, if you want...
So Dresser gets announced as a coach, I think, I don't know if he finished, he didn't finish out his time at Virginia Tech, maybe not the national tournament. I think maybe he did or didn't, I'm not sure. And then he came back to Ames, started assembling the staff, and in typical Dresser form, like he's when he takes the headlines, he's gonna take all the headlines. He went after guys that were athletes at the University of Iowa, successful at the University of Iowa, under Tom Brands, that had moved ways or parted ways, and he gave everybody the big fuck you and said, I'm gonna take all the guys that aren't good enough for Iowa or aren't part of Iowa's entourage anymore. Zadik, which you would say another one is extremely close to Tom, Derek St. John, national champ, and the face of Iowa wrestling up to that point before Spencer Lee got there. Brett Metcalf was it. He hired Metcalf, he hired St. John, he hired freaking Zadik. I've never asked Tom this, but that had to be a fucking kick right in the teeth.
And then he sits down at his intro press conference and he's surrounded by former Hawkeyes, which I think is kind of funny. Very cool, but also kind of funny. You know, St. John came with him from Virginia Tech, you know, and then Zadik was there as well. I think Metcalf had just finished up at the Hawkeye Wrestling Club. And so to me, I was like, okay, not only is he coming back here, that's interesting and really cool for Iowa State, but he's bringing, like, naturally you think, okay, a lot of former Hawkeye wrestlers, but a lot of guys that have pretty good track records as coaches. And so it's like, okay, like, this is interesting.
Joe's Fight Night 2017. Pretty much could be the first time that Tom and Dresser come face to face, right? On a quote unquote fight night. Dresser staff was there, Metcalf. I think Metcalf was for sure there. And I was representative as the one and only Thomas P. Gilman, right? And it was no, there was intention to send a Gilman there.
World silver medalist, Thomas Gilman, here we go.
Gilman had graduated at that point. He'd just come off a silver medal, I think, at the World Championships earlier that month.
World Championships. I was a world silver medalist. Like Gable said, that's not where I need to be, not where I want to be. People in here can congratulate me all you want. I guess I'll take it. People tell me, yeah, I was never a Hawk fan. I was never a Gilman fan. But, you know, once you graduated from Iowa, you know, I became a Gilman fan because, we're on the same team now, Team USA. You know what I say to that? I say, you.
A soldier, quote-unquote, for Tom Brands?
Yeah, you're right. Tom's not here. He's got better things to do, I guess, than sit here and argue with Dresser and Schwab here. Fighting for scraps over here.
People knew what was going to happen. When you see Gilman walk in.
Tom's out, you know, getting big bucks. Bucks as in money.
That can be seen a lot of different ways, right? Like, it wasn't an obligation for Tom to be there from a university standpoint of media. But why didn't he come?
And, you know, he's got to do what he's got to do. And if that means delegating things to me and our coaching staff, that's what that means. So you want to see Tom Brands come down to Iowa City. best place in the world, best place in the country to watch wrestling, to wrestle, to practice. These guys know it. They're just too afraid to admit it.
Like, clips from that night start flying, right? Thomas Gilman's, you know, jawing, which is what he does. I think Kevin Dresser was jawing.
I'm a little different. I like to get up close and personal and warm and soft and fuzzy, all right?
People remember the Iowa State, you know, talk from that night.
Back in the 80s in Iowa City, we worked really hard. We played hard. We had a good time. By the way, we won 9 straight NCAA championships. I don't know, when's the last time Iowa won a national championship in wrestling?
If guys really want to, if people want to be tongue-in-cheek, like, well, or if guys really want to approach that like fight night, emotions are going to run high. Like, you got to remember now, VT5, guy that gets hired, guy that calls the other guy a pussy.
That, how many Cyclone Wrestling Club guys you got competing around, or Panther Wrestling Club guys, world team members, anything? I'm not sure.
We all wore black and gold, and when we wore black and gold, we loved it. And it was a different black and gold then. We didn't dodge anybody in those days. In fact, we went out of our way to wrestle everybody as much and as often as we could.
Just kind of added a little bit of fuel to it, which is fun, because, you know, like, Iowa has just consistently beaten them, and for so many years they beat them badly. And so, like, now you've got this new staff in place, and you've got guys that are not scared to just, like, yell back.
And then at 97, I mean, Corbray's coming off a loss, coming off the flu, and I'm sure you wanted him to get him a match. What was your thoughts on that?
I think it's a chicken blank move. Total, you know, we went and found a guy at 7-11 and wrestled him all year at 125, and they weigh in a guy at 197 and don't wrestle him. Okay, that's probably the difference between the two programs. And the day will come when we even the score here, and this will be a dual meet, and we don't roll that way, but they can roll how they want to roll.
2018 dual, Iowa's at wrestling Iowa State and at Hilton. Blank and Iowa State up to the 197 match. The only match that they're really favored in the duel, and Tom forfeits. Dresser says that was a chicken shit move. Chicken blank move, and Tom smiles off in the sunset and says, okay, we went in names and we fucking blanked you guys. We had to give you the match you guys won. We gave it to you. You didn't beat us. We gave it to you. I felt so bad I gave it to you. And listen, more gas goes on the fire. Like, it was, if you really think about it, if the relationship and things are at that point, it was a brilliant move. People think a lot of things about Tom Brands. He's pretty freaking smart. I mean, I'm not going to give you the glory of maybe beating us in a match. I'm going to give it to you. Hey, I know you're the new guy. Like, you. Here you go. Here's one.
2017, 2018, they actually technically dueled each other twice.
Yeah, once in February, once in December.
Correct. Let's talk about the February one first.
So
the
bloodbath. Absolute bloodbath. That February duel was just... It was the way it had always been. Iowa didn't have to wrestle all their guys, you know? And to be honest, they probably didn't want to. They probably wanted to do enough work on the front end that they could just get out of there and move along. Which is what happened, and Kevin Dresser took exception to that.
Listen, 2019 was a freaking wild duel. Like, I was picked to freaking, I think they were picked to win like 7 matches. They ended up winning by 1 point, and it comes down to Austin Gomez throws Austin DeSanto to his back, and if he gets the pin, freaking Iowa State's gonna win. And freaking DeSanto fought his ass off for like 45, 50 seconds. Doesn't get the pin, they lose by 1. Iowa State does. You know, I think Tom made a comment somewhere like, you know, if guys are for moral victories, then I guess they won.
Dresser, we have a relationship. When I came to Iowa, he was still here. Got to know him then, so I've known him since 1987. And then when he left Iowa, he went to a place called Grundy, Virginia, and then he went to a place called Christiansburg, Virginia. And then when I took the job at Virginia, so I did some camps for him. And then when I went to Virginia Tech, he was still at Christiansburg as a high school coach. And so, you know, he had a a good program there, and we recruited some of his guys, and so the relationship was strong. And then I got hired back in Iowa, and that's where the probably the intersection is, where people want to make something out of, you know, Blacksburg, Virginia. You know, I recruited the number one class there. I. Well, it really wasn't me. It was Doug Schwab and Wes Hand and we. So we recruited the number one class at Virginia Tech. And when I got hired back at Iowa, Schwab and Hand were hired back with me. I hired my staff. And it's a natural fit that these guys want to come with us. And so where the maybe the butt in the heads comes from, or what everybody wants the inside story is that, you know what, Virginia Tech's administration and coaching staff made a concerted effort to keep those guys there, and they had no interest in staying there. That's the fact of the matter. I lived it. I know what the truth is. You can debate the truth all you want, but I know what the truth is. All right, and so what am I trying to say? Well, those guys couldn't come on campus because they weren't released. They couldn't come on campus. They had to get into school on their own at Iowa. They could not come on campus. That's a violation. So we weren't shady about it. Bowlesby was the AD at the time. We're going to play this clean. And my brother was a coach at Colorado Springs. He was national resident coach in Colorado Springs. And so those guys went out and trained in Colorado Springs, Colorado. So a guy like Brent Metcalf went to Colorado Springs and trained under Terry Brands because Virginia Tech and Kevin Dresser would not allow him or release him to follow who he signed for at the University of Iowa. And so the funny thing is that Tom and Terry Brand shared an egg. Now, we're different, but our commitment and our philosophy are pretty similar, and our standards are really similar. And so Terry had these guys that weren't released to come to school at Iowa until the first day of class when they enrolled. And he had these great young kids that are the best kids in the country of their age group after a year of college that his brother coached were in his wrestling room. He couldn't have been happier. He'd call me every night and be like, hey, this is the best thing ever. I know we can't really talk about them because they were unrecruitable because they weren't released. And so that's the story. But Dresser and me,
there is bad blood.
No, there's not. He's called me names. He called me an orange, and he substituted that for pussy, and he was afraid to say that word. I don't know if you can say that on the air or not, but it really doesn't matter because it didn't bother me.
Sounds like kind of bad blood.
No, not for me. It's not for him. I mean, I saw him in the lobby of a hotel that year at the Nationals. I walked up to him. Hey, can we call me names, man? We shook hands. We looked at each other, and we had a good conversation that lasted 30 seconds. We had a great conversation. It's okay. It's really not bad blood. It's really not.
It's good. I think it's good for the sport, whatever kind of blood it is.
He hired me to do camps when he was a high school coach. So, I mean, am I really an orange? Am I really a pussy? Would he hire a pussy to come coach his team? I don't think so. I think he's going to hire the best, toughest, most knowledgeable wrestler on planet Earth to come and help him look good and boost his program. How's that? I mean, you don't hire people that you don't respect. So you can't change the story, guys, can you? Can you change the story just because?
Apparently not.
Yeah, you can't change the story. Yeah. Come on.
2021 duel, Iowa ranked number two at the time. I'm not sure what Iowa State was ranked. They had returning national champ David Carr. Bastida was, you know, an up-and-comer. Marcus Coleman. But Iowa on paper should, you know, run away with the duel.
What do you think? Who's going to win?
Iowa.
Yeah.
In 2021, Iowa wins pretty handily. Like, people that remember the duel itself and remember, you know, if you go look at the box score, like, it's not a close duel. But there is a palpable energy about the duel itself inside Hilton. I mean, it's sold out. It's probably 50-50 fans, you know, Iowa and Iowa State.
Iowa State came to wrestle, man. It was a fire duel. You want to talk about emotions? Like, if people want to know, if people know what they're doing, it's causing anything. Like every chance that Tom had, he would, you know, to be real quiet. It was not like. I don't remember what the score was of the duel.
Doesn't matter what the score was. A couple key moments of the duel were, I mean, the biggest moment that probably set it off was when Mesita beats Warner and he spikes the freaking headgear. Place to eruption. Coaches at Iowa State reflect, you know, yelling across it. It was their big time to yell across the freaking mat. Emotions were high. Then you go into heavyweight, right?
And then DeSantos, you want the mic, buddy?
Where Cassiope's heavily favored over his wrestling, right? And the epitome of what you wouldn't want to happen in the duel, Cassiope stalls the guy out.
There is a palpable energy in the building that day that I have just never felt before when it comes to covering Iowa and Iowa State. Like, it is intense. Every match means a little more. And it was fun. It was a lot of fun. Like, I remember, just as a general wrestling fan, like, that's what you want in a rivalry. Like, you want all 10 matches to matter so much. You want the crowd to get into it both ways.
That ends the duel, right? This ref, like, man, what are you, like, are you trying to start the first 48? Duel ends. Terry Brands, as he always does, kind of run, you know, he runs over to the other side real quick. Well, he runs across, shake hands, whatever, and him and St. John, I think he shoulder bumped St. John, right? The emotions are high. And then he runs around through all the Iowa State guys and kind of around back to the thing. Well, DeSanto won. Remember, if you remember DeSanto won, he went to the friggin' and he's shaking the fence in front of everybody. And tension went from like 0 to 100, like boom.
You don't really want the fights at the end of the duel, but you love that the benches are like yelling at each other and going crazy, and like, you know, Austin DeSanto coming up behind Kyvan, like, commentate that, right? Like, you want that type of energy in a rivalry duel. And for the first time that I can remember, like, not even during the 1918 duel, you know, that Iowa squeaked out, like, there wasn't that energy in Carver that day. And maybe it's because it was in Carver and the vast majority of the fans were Iowa and they were, like, you know, all kind of sitting on their hands coming down the stretch there, because it's like, are we gonna win the duel? But like that night in Hilton, that was spectacular. That was college wrestling at its best. That was sports rivalries at its best. And I hope that's what we get moving forward, because that makes it a lot more fun.
We got to go to Iowa City next year. Obviously, the way that ended last year was pretty dramatic. But are you looking forward to going to Iowa City next year?
Yeah, I know we're looking forward to it. You know, it's full force ahead, right? How do I tiptoe around this without being politically incorrect? I'll just stay politically correct and say we're looking forward to it.
What do I think the actual relationship is between Kevin Dresser and Tom Brands? I think that from a competitive standpoint, it's a mutual respect. You have to respect the other ones, or they're a threat, right? I think from a personal standpoint, I think maybe polite and cordial when need to be. Not somebody you're going to sit down and have a cup of coffee with or lunch with, dinner. I think there'll be no love lost. I think it's become more than personal. Every shot that the other one could take to try to humiliate or embarrass the other one, they've taken it.
That's a good question. I think there is a level of probably professional respect between each other, you know, and I've talked with both coaches, but there's definitely right underneath that professional respect is just like those two guys probably want to rip each other's heads off.